Good evening. You know, one of the top songs, or one of the top tunes this time of the year, is Joy to the World, The Lord Has Come, Let Earth Receive Our King. I'm referring to the Christmas story, the Christmas carol, the Christmas song that we sing so lustily this time of the year. And this evening, we want to look a bit at the Christmas story and focus on someone who not very much is spoken about at the time of Christmas when we talk about the Christmas story and all of the things that surround Christmas. I'm referring to Joseph. And so this evening, we want you to sit back, relax, as we share some interesting information, some interesting characterization about Joseph. And so invite a friend, call your neighbors, and you can sit with your ginger beer in hand, you can sit with your black cake in hand, and even some choice pepper pot, and you know all the cultural things that go with Christmas. And we are going to have a wonderful discussion. So join us. Gentlemen, good evening.
You know, thank you, Dr. Lee. You know, some theologians describe Joseph as the forgotten person in the whole story of the Advent. They describe him as the forgotten individual. But today we want to bring to light the importance of Joseph and the role that he played in the entire process of the Advent. First of all, Joseph was chosen by God. He was identified to carry this particular aspect of the whole salvation process. And why was he chosen? We get a sense that from scripture, how he operated, how he conducted himself, that he was an upright man. Joseph was an upright man, a man who stood for what is right, what is honest, what is decent. He was considerate. His story, it is not easy for someone, it's not easy for you to be told that the person you have married is a virgin, is now pregnant, you know. And as men, we could think about, our minds will fly all over the place. But God chose this man specifically because he knew of some of these prevailing characteristics that he had. So he was upright, he was considerate, and very important, he was obedient. Because again, think about it, Reverend Son, you were told that your virgin wife is now pregnant. I mean, you might want to put her aside and cast her away, because who wants to know that you all your life you say, I have to get a virgin, and then you hear that this virgin is now pregnant and it is not by you. So he was obedient because he was spoken to about this whole process. He protected his family. We saw Joseph raising the man Jesus in the fear of God, raising him as a young man. So Joseph performed his role. So he protected his family, and he demonstrated care and concern for his family. And you know what? I mean, as men, we could think about how we may have responded and said, but let us put the spotlight on Joseph. Let us see what this man went through and how he dealt with his situation and still turned out to be one of the best fathers in what we might want to call a step family, because he was the foster father of the man Jesus. And so we want to have continued discussions. Thank you.
Dr. Hudson, you're phenomenal. I want to say thanks for such an introduction, and thanks to Dr. Lee. What fascinates me, and I must give credit to my bishop who's on this program, who came up with our discussion today. I have never recognized Joseph in such a light. The Christmas or the Advent has always been surrounding what the angel said to Mary. I went as far as what the angel did to Zacharias, said to Zacharias, what he did to him, what happened to Elizabeth and Zacharias. What I have never stopped to recognize the significance of Joseph. Joseph was a real man. I want to say thanks. He reminds me of myself. And I say that because as I went through the story, I was asked to check it And I couldn't find any recording where Joseph actually spoke directly in the entire event, the entire Advent. But yet still, as the word of God is spoken to him, Joseph, do this and do that, I found how he obeyed, willingly followed the word of God. He's a strong man. You can't call him a weakling, because then Mary discovered that Mary was pregnant. Like most men, he thought of putting her away. But you see his strength coming out as God is encouraging him that this is a work of God. You see him stand up and take that woman as his wife, marry her, raise that child. He's an amazing fellow. And I want to say that many times as men, we find ourselves in those kinds of scenarios. Our actions so many times could be so contrary to Joseph's action. He's a very good example for us to follow today. Let's us examine him further.
When you think about family, yes, your family, at this time, there are some people who believe that, well, you know, I don't have this right, I don't have that right, I don't have this, I don't have that. So you relegate yourself to the background and you're dismissive of how could such the nativity scene, how can you benefit from the greatest story ever told? Stop disqualifying yourself. We have no record of what Joseph said. The Bible doesn't give us what he said. There's no recording like that. But he played a principal role. So what can we take away from this at this Christmas time and onward? Don't ever allow people to define you. Joseph had an intimate relationship, a vertical relationship with his God. So much so that in his dream, as we heard early on, his character predisposed him well to the assignments he was given. Clearly, Joseph was another man who talked a lot. Could it be that sovereignly he was chosen? As I think, I allowed Joshua to make his own case, because he made an interesting reference to Zechariah. Just around the same time, this was happening in two homes.
What is interesting to note is that Zechariah, who is Mary's cousin's husband, about 3 months earlier, or thereabouts, as the scripture would have it, John the Baptist was conceived or being conceived by his mom, Zachariah and Elizabeth. Sorry about that. And it's interesting, when the angel met Zechariah as he was serving in the temple, and the angel told Zechariah about John the Baptist, and you'll name this child John, and so on, Zechariah questioned the angel. And the angel in turn identified himself, and the scripture records that the angel muted Zechariah until the birth of the child John. And that's interesting, because we see now with Joseph, Jesus, the father of Mary's husband, he didn't have a word to say. He didn't have anything to say, but scripture records that he acted in obedience to what God had said through the angel. So one man spoke and questioned what God was saying, and was muted until what God said came to pass. And then this other man, he kept silent, but he obeyed. He worked. The scripture records how he moved, even though he didn't say anything, he moved in accordance with obedience. And these are two contrasting approaches. But we want to encourage men, even if you're not a talkative person, to manage your words, but more than that, to obey what God has said, to obey the will of God.
You know, Joshua, I like how you characterize it. But if I can just go back a bit to Joseph, the first description or the first adjective that we have that describes Joseph was the word righteous. Joseph was a righteous man. And we see from that description, from that adjective use, his actions concurred with the adjective used to describe him. Righteous, and the scripture continues by saying, being a righteous man, he did not want to disgrace Mary publicly, and so he decided to divorce her secretly. The point in all of this here, it is one thing to say that you are righteous, or for me to say I'm righteous, but if my actions do not support what I'm saying or how I characterize myself, well, then I'm making a fool of myself. So Joseph was described as being righteous, and I want to applaud his efforts or his actions subsequently in what he intended, well, his intended action, how we should treat Mary. So gentlemen, I mean, you know, this time we brag and boast about so many things, you know, we are men, we are good fathers and all of that. But I want us to take a few moments. What have you done, or what have we done for our children? How do we treat with our children? How do we treat with our spouses? I mean, we can say one thing, but what our actions are saying. Just think about it for a few moments.
Thank you, Doctor. Looking at this program, Christmas Eve Day. And as we are trying to get your attention, I know there are many distractions. We are trying to get your attention. I like how Joshua used the word muted, that Zachariah was muted. He's describing him like if he was a cell phone. You know? Oh, we mute. The angel of God has exceptional power, and he was made dumb because he dared to question. Now, right across the city, just around the same time, in the same geographical location, another man was chosen. And the announcement that was given to that other man was very serious. You heard it. And we are discussing Matthew chapter 1 from 18 to 25. That's the context of our discussion. You can read Isaiah 9 and read Luke's account. But Jesus, the Savior of the world, some of us might think he had to come from a perfect environment. No, he was raised in a blended family, or what we call, I think we call it a blended family. And the strength and the aura of this man, Joseph, must have rubbed off a whole lot on him. The way how he treated his mother, this is Jesus' mother. The way how Joseph, scripture calls Joseph Mary's husband. We never describe as the father of Joseph. But Joseph was a strong man. And one of the things you'll observe about men, not all men, is that some men internalize a lot. In the face of situations, while you are trying to grapple with X, Y, and Z, that man, yeah, your man, might be sitting right there and you're not getting a peep out of him because the inner motto is working. And some of you trying to understand this guy, you know, Joseph was not given to a whole lot of speech making. But Joseph played his role well. We hear that he was obedient and he did what he was told. Don't allow people to disqualify you. You've been fearfully and wonderfully made, sir. And your role in your family is very, very critical. Court, I welcome to Guyana. And I know you are itching. Go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir. It's good to be home. It's always good to be home in the warmth and sun. And I'm happy the day we're recording it is not raining, so it's great to be home. As we discuss Joseph, and I'm listening and I'm internalizing as well as a man, and two words came to mind, mental strength. You know, Joseph is a strong man. Yes, we all agree. But he's not only strong physically. Mentally, he's exceptionally strong, in my opinion. Why would I say that? Joseph was betrothed. This lady was already his wife, but he had not slept with her as yet. And this lady became pregnant. And Joseph is dealing with all of this, as you said in Matthew, from verse 18 to 25, as we were reading. And the scripture said he's internalized and he began thinking. And every version you could look at of the Bible, that is, Joseph was a righteous man. Joseph was a just man. Joseph was a faithful man. Extremely important, those attitudes to describe this young man. Extremely important, righteous, just, faithful. So he was internalizing what to do. And then he got a word of what to do. And Joseph obeyed. He got an angelic intervention. So you see, all of his mental struggles, whatever he was going through, whatever he was internalizing, we don't want to assume anything. We're not going to put any words in the Bible. Whatever he was internalizing, he got an angelic intervention that strengthened his mental fortitude. He was strong. That is important. We are men. And we do not say a lot. We internalize a lot, as you rightly said, Bishop. And this strange phenomena, this is something strange. It never occurred before to his wife. How would he react? How should he react? But we are happy that we have this example of Joseph. In this time, at this Advent, in this season, Joseph stayed. Joseph stayed the course. Joseph even ended up naming the son, the boy, at that time, in that culture, as the father of the child should do. He gave him the name Jesus. Extremely important for me. I would say in closing, irrespective of who we are, whatever our character is, we all will have troubles. How do we react to those troubles? Look at Joseph. He's an excellent example of reacting to challenges.
I think I heard earlier that on this program somewhere, or just before we started, that adoption is the highest form of parenting. And that's biblical. That is theological. I believe that. I think, Dr. Hudson, I heard about an amazing story. I can't talk your story. You will have to talk that one. But what I found was how Joseph took this child and raised this child in spite of all of the background we are just discussing. And God has honored him for that. It's amazing. And I want to encourage us. Dr. Hudson, I like to hear the story because I'm always fascinated by it.
Thank you, Rev. Well, I come from a reasonably large family, a family of 10. My father, when he took my mother, she had 5 children. And then he added of his own 5 biological children in that 5. I'm the 4th for that 5. But the thing is, none of the other siblings that were not his biological children, they were treated differently. When he worked, he ensured that all of us ate, all of us had a place to sleep, and that kind of thing. And, you know, that's so important as a man to function as the backbone of a family. You know, we all know that God created the man as head. As head of the family, and there's a reason for that. He's the cover. And so we want all the men to know today the men who are listening to us, that you have a responsibility to cover your family. Whether the children are yours biologically, or you've adopted them, or you've gone into a blended situation, once you've gone there, you know, we have a responsibility to cover and to empower them and to provide and to ensure that, you know, that they're able to fulfill their potential. Because like we saw, you know, a blessing is in store for you as you move in that direction. God doesn't believe in abandonment and leaving people, you know, leaving your children to hang out, but to take care, to nourish and to train and to teach. So could you imagine if all the men in this country decide, you know what, this is how we're going to function. I know some men might say, me taking home with no children and son, but you know, sometimes that person is the person for you. All your life, you might have been looking for settling. The moment you find somebody, you said, you know something, this is the one. And Bishop, as I'm talking, you told me about the Harry and the Meghan thing. You know, I started to look at him. I said, look at this man. This man took a woman from outside of his own position, his own family structure, where they have certain kinds of principles, and this man went outside. That man is a real man. You know what I mean? He is really empowered and show people that there's a blessing attached to you from God based upon how you react to the situation, because he's now breaking down racial barriers, moral barriers. You know, all of these things can be done as men decide to, you know, be obedient to God.
I want to relate to my younger audience that are listening. I love the point that Dr. Lee and Pastor Kurt made with the thoughts. And how even though Joseph was righteous, he had these thoughts. And it had me thinking, I was going to make another point, but I wanted to make this point so that I can let my people my age or men my age understand that no matter how righteous you are, you will still have negative thoughts. Like, thoughts will plague your mind, and that is a perfect or a normal part of the Christian walk. But importantly, like what Pastor Kurt highlighted, how did Joseph deal with these negative thoughts or these thoughts that he had? Obedience. What did Paul say? How to deal with thoughts, negative thoughts? Bring them into the obedience of Christ Jesus. Cast down every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God. So whenever you're plagued with negative thoughts or thoughts that are contrary or seems to go outside of the will of God, bring them back into the obedience of Christ. Bring them back into the obedience of God, and you will live a purpose-driven life. Because if we look at recently, a very famous dancer died, a guy by the name of Twitch. All of the young people may know him. And he had the perfect family. He had a wife and two beautiful children, but yet still he struggled mentally. No one understood what he was going through. He committed suicide. But there's a clear formula. There's a clear path to take to deal with this thought, these thoughts. It's not a matter of if they will come, because I can guarantee you they will come, but there's a clear mandate. Take them, bring them back into the obedience of Christ. Look at Joseph. He wanted to put away his wife. He wanted to do this and wanted to do that. These things could be suggested to any one of us. Bring them back into the obedience of Christ Jesus, and you will walk a purpose-driven life.
And as Christians in a time like this, crisis management, that's what you saw Joseph doing there. It was about being able to manage the situation, manage that information, and understand, you know, by the grace of God, how will he move forward, you know? And his reaction wasn't to just put her away. It wasn't just to run away or anything like that. But he waited on a message from God and he obeyed it. So when you met with a conflict like that, or you met in a situation where there might be a crisis, you must have faith in God and focus on him. Look to him first for your solutions. And I could even say that could put a lot of pressure on you, you know, from personal experience. When you're going through a situation and you can't interpret the information that is in front of you, it makes no sense. And your mind starts to think, this could be game over. Or this is another 3 weeks I got to spend doing something, you know. Have faith in God, follow the process, look to him, and he's going to help you through that crisis.
Joseph, in verse 25 of Matthew 1. Everything that is said here about Joseph the guy didn't have an idea, I think, of what will play out with this child that would be born. He was simply obedient. I don't know if he understood who Jesus was. I don't know if he saw 2022. You and I, with all of our problems and difficulties, I don't know if Joseph felt bold to go out in the open, knowing that there would be people who would say, look, Joseph, and talk about Mary. But he did that. He did everything he had to do. He also did a remarkable thing that fathers would do. Now, in his heart of hearts, he knew he was not the father. But he named him. He didn't ask for an understanding. He made no apology. But he said, his name is Jesus. Perhaps, you know, he is the Savior. Joseph is authenticating the deliverer, introducing the Savior, announcing to his family, his friends, within his culture, he is Christ with us, this baby. And he had the privilege, the people at the registry who would record the name recorded what Joseph said. And posterity records that it was Joseph, the silent man, who named him Jesus. He was faithful right to the end. And that's what this season is about. Think about being as faithful as Joseph was. Think about loving, as we heard our my colleague say early on. And think about introducing the silent one, introducing the greatest one, Jesus. Merry Christmas from Choices. God bless you real good.
We thank you for joining us on Choices today. Remember, you can join us at First Assembly, LNP Durban Street, Redmondville, Georgetown, Guyana, for any of our special services. I'm Salacia on behalf of the set, reminding you that your whole life is the sum of your choices. God bless you.